Support for Steppin' Out is made possible by local author Sarada Bonnet. In Notes of Forgiveness, Bonnet shares her childhood story as daughter of famed rockabilly singer Sherry Davis. Notes of Forgiveness, available in bookstores and at saradabonnet.com.
Good evening, I'm Peggy Scott Laborde, and welcome to Steppin' Out, spotlighting the New Orleans area's arts and entertainment scene. And seated at our table tonight, photographer Tina Freeman, here to discuss her brand new book, Artist Spaces, New Orleans. Welcome, Tina.
Thank you so much, Peggy, for having me tonight.
At our table, yay. And Puppy Tooker with an exclamation point, host of the WWNO radio program, Louisiana Eats. Love your chapeau, darling.
It's my favorite holiday.
Clearly.
Happy Halloween.
Thank you, darling. Thank you. And Dominic Massa, executive producer and special projects director at WWL-TV, and author, he's an author of the new book, New Orleans Radio. Congratulations, Dom.
Thank you. I'm not dressed for Halloween because I knew Poppy would be dressed enough for all of us, and she is, so you look great.
She didn't fail us.
And you should see her in July. She even looks that good with that hat on.
Absolutely. And Alan Smason, he's back, editor of the online Crescent City Jewish News. Hey,
it'll
Alan.
Scare you up again.
Scare you up. Okay, and now though, let's start with Poppy.
Next Friday, before everybody tunes in to Steppin' Out, they should come and join me at Hazelnut on Magazine Street, where they are hosting a Vietri artist event. This is a very unusual opportunity. From 4 until 7, next Friday, Stefano Rosselli, this is one of his only stops in the United States, and he's one of the Italian porcelain Vietri's chief designers. He's going to be making pieces, he's going to be signing pieces, and I talked to Brian Bett yesterday, and Brian said, of course they'll be serving Prosecco. Of course. This is absolutely a no-miss event. See you next Friday, 4 till 7, before Steppin' Out. And then, something really fun and new coming to downtown. Every Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday at 11 a.m., the first week of every month, November through April, Taste on Common. That's going to be rotating food trucks. And so it's going to be a wonderful opportunity for people to just
CBD.
Pour out of those downtown buildings in the CBD. St. Clair Pizza, Foodie Call, La Cocinita, Frenchies, Dirty Dishes, Burger You Heard, Diva Dog, and the Nola Cluck Truck will all be down there on a rotating basis.
Could you run that list by me one more time?
The Nola Cluck Truck, don't forget that. But speaking of clucking, lot of clucking about to happen on St. Charles Avenue because Willie Mae Seton's granddaughter, Carrie, is about to open, well, actually, today, she has opened Willie Mae's Grocery and Deli. It's where the former Red Hen used to be.
Sure.
And right there uptown, you can look forward to having everything from Willie Mae's Scotch House, including the wet battered fried chicken, the pork chop, and some new items like poor boys salads and wraps. And they're going to be serving 7 days a week from 11 a.m. until 9 p.m. So you can get that chicken on anytime you want. They'll be clucking over there. Then, down in the Marigny, something that's been eagerly anticipated, Bao and Noodle. This is a new Chinese restaurant from Herb Saint alum, Doug Crowell. And Doug is doing some really magical food down there. I sat down, I looked at the menu, there was something called strange flavored peanuts. That's the name of them, but they really weren't strange flavored at all. They were good. Also, you can get delicious things, all sorts of steamed buns, some of them also fried on one side. And every day, he's got a whole fish that's steamed
that's
in a
so
delicious
beautiful.
Sauce. There are scallion pancakes, and then they're making beautiful homemade noodles. That's the Dan Dan. They're down there lunch through dinner, Tuesday through Saturday, 11:30 to 2:30 for lunch, and 5 until 10 on for dinner in the evenings, and it is BYOB.
Okay, great. Thank you so
much. Very reasonable, delicious.
And as a little PS in terms of your food segment, we have to thank our dear friend Maria K. Cheddar, who every year sends us these beautiful homemade Halloween cookies. Okay, and whoo, these pops, of course, shaped like the ghosts. So thank you, Maria K. It is the season, absolutely. And we turn to Tina, and once again, congratulations on your most beautiful book. If anyone really respects an artist, it's you. And the way that you've documented their spaces, I have a question as we show, of course, some images from the book. Was it hard, though, to say, okay, I'm going to leave it all alone, I'm just going to take the pictures, or did you say, well, let me just move this over here?
No. I left everything alone. I mean, that's the beauty of taking photographs of spaces that you love. In fact, in the book, I kind of talk about taking spaces with a decorator and how I pretty much decided not to do photographs for decorators because this particular decorator was redecorating the house of a person that lived there. So I love the way that the artist spaces reflect the artist and reflect their work and reflect a beauty. I mean, there's something about New Orleans artist spaces that have this extraordinary beauty, and someone said they all look so neat. But that's the way they looked. I don't know whether it's New Orleans artists or
what. Well, I love
the
cover and the fact that you dedicated the book to the late George Durow, the late great George Durow.
Yes. And the cover is his studio on Dauphine Street.
Well, as we discuss this further, though, we'll show some of the images. And it really is quite a mix of neighborhoods, of different artistic styles. How do you choose?
It was kind of by chance. I started with George right before Katrina, and then I stopped. And then I started photographing friends' places. And then I started photographing friends of friends. And we just, you know, it was an organic, but I'm sure, I know I left out lots of people. And so it's hard to say why I photographed what I did, but it was mostly places that I knew or places that other people, friends of mine, knew. So that's the group.
There's
George's
wonderful
old
place
old friend Erzy, the photographer before this, is a really good friend of mine. We were in second grade together, and she was also a good friend of George's. Mm-hmm. Kevin Klein was a new friend, but his space was just extraordinary.
Well, is it about also the light?
Lynn Emery, old friend. I mean, she's just, well, who can say anything but an amazing woman about Lynn Emery. And Nicole Charbonnet's new space in an old mattress factory, which the light. And that's a wonderful thing about artist spaces is they generally have absolutely stupendous light. And Willie Birch, I had only met Willie just a short time before I went to photograph his studio, but he's just a very interesting man.
And he is. He's delightful to talk to.
I've made some good new friends.
Oh, well, wonderful. And I know you have two book signings coming uptown in the next few days, and we'll show those as we chat. But I know you've been a photographer for a long time, but how did you get interested in photography?
I think it was a family obsession. My father took a lot of photographs when we travel, and one of my older brothers also, both brothers actually, photographed. And then I learned how to use a darkroom when I was 12. Mm-hmm. And I have a BFA in photography, so it's a long-standing passion.
Very good. Well, congratulations.
Well, thank you.
I'm very excited for you. Is there another book in the
Yes, there is. There is. I'm doing a book for Rizzoli on Longview House and Gardens, which hopefully will be out next year.
Oh, what a gem.
Yes.
What a gem. Yeah. Gee, what, looking forward to that. Yeah. Thank you. And in honor of tonight, in this night of trick-or-treating, we have a special treat for you. Our production associate, Kelsey Schreiber, and her family are batty about Halloween. Kelsey gives us a tour of their Halloween home.
Here in Metairie, my family and I take Halloween pretty seriously. Come on in and see. Here in our dining room, we have a haunted mantle, a Halloween tree, and creepy skulls. This is my friend Creature. He helps me do the dishes. This chef's souffle fell, so we ended it. This this is the Frankenstein fireplace. It's alive! And be careful of the devil. He may drag you into Hades. Here's our horror movie and TV diorama bookcase. Each shelf represents a movie or TV show. There's Ghostbusters. Who are you gonna call? There's Night of the Living Dead. And zombies. There's the Munsters. We have to have the Master of Horror, Alfred Hitchcock, and the Birds. We have Gremlins, with all the cute and scary Gremlins. We've got a clown shelf, with It and Killer Clowns from Outer Space. There's Flying Saucers. We've got classic Universal Monsters right in the center. Be sure to watch where you walk in our living room. You don't want to sink into any Ness quicksand. Carry some silver bullets with you when you visit our werewolf corner. How about a slice of pizza? And Morgus doesn't have anything on our mad scientist. Dem bones, dem bones. We sure do have a lot of bones. Be sure to watch your brains when you walk into our zombie area. We think the infection started when these toxic waste barrels spilled. Enjoyed our spooktacular home. Happy Halloween!
And Kelsey has made ours happier, and also special thanks to Steve Gombieski for that great, great feature. Wonderful stuff here. And now we turn to Mr. Dom.
Top that.
Let me just say, Dom, is anybody who knows you're obsessed, okay, thank goodness, by the history, very good way, by TV and radio. Only you could have pulled this together. But let's talk about your book.
Well, it is, I guess, an obsession is maybe a strong word for it, but always an interest in broadcasting history and nurtured here at WYES with some of the programs that we've done here at the station, and then now in book form. I should say, though, I'm with two radio stars, a current radio star and a former in his heyday radio star who now does many other things. But
what a great cover. We should definitely point out.
That's the Dawn Busters from WWL Radio, the heyday from the 30s through the 50s. They were on for many years on WWL in the morning. Margie O'Dare, Pinky Vidakovich, and Henry Dupre at the microphone. That's a great photo from Loyola's archives. But this book really started, was an outgrowth of the television book. I did it backwards. I did television first in 2008, then I did radio. Being that I'm a TV person, it was more natural to do the television book. This was also more challenging because finding photos was harder. Yeah. As many names as we know from the past, it was hard to find a photo of folks. And sometimes we joke about having a face for radio. Maybe that's why. Mm-hmm. The face for the radio photograph of the person. I don't know.
But we were able to find some good ones. Will seem very familiar.
We start way back in the early days with WWL, 1922, and then talk about the Dawn Busters and Henry Dupre and Pinky Vidakovich, who people will remember. The brains behind that show and the Cajun jokes and humor and songs that they would do every morning on WWL. And then Henry Dupre crossed over into television, as did Bob and Jan Carr, two of our favorites. And many people may not know they were on WWL. They came to New Orleans to WWL and then moved over to WDSU television. This is one of my favorite photographs from the book, from the HNOC, the Mike Smith collection,
that is
of
something.
Papa Stoppa and a young Dr. John, Mac Rebenek. Papa Stoppa, people may not even know what he looked like, but that's what he looked like, because you knew his voice, but maybe not his face. And then Bob Walker, the oldie king, who was a great friend of this project and lent me a lot of his photos. Here he is with Sonny and Cher from the WTIX days. We also talk about black radio, and Larry McKinley was such a pioneer there in the civil rights era and beyond, and also, of course, the great voice of Jazz Fest, and a great voice all around. Dr. Daddy-O, we focus on, and Larry McKinley. Nut and Jeff at WSMB, who were, of course, on for many years, from the 60s through the 80s at WSMB, and talk radio, really, as a genre. Larry Regan, Keith Rush, Nut and Jeff in the heyday of WSMB.
Whoops.
And a young man you may know, Alan Smason, who also was a great radio star on WSMB, WWL. Where else, Alan?
WTUL. I was the oldies show, the first oldie show in New Orleans. I started there, yeah.
And you have to buy the book, but we also have a picture of course, Andy Calandri, which you'll have to see inside.
Who you really know his voice if you don't know his face, but yes, you really know his voice here on WYES every day.
Yeah. So. And you've got a book signing coming up.
We do, next Thursday, November 6th at Garden District in the evening at 6 p.m., and we'll have some of the stars of the book.
Yeah, who's going to be with you?
Bob Walker, Keith Rush, who you may not have seen lately. We'll have him there, and the voice is still as strong.
Oh, yeah.
Ed Clancy and pal Al Nasser, maybe Alan Smason will be joining us as well, some other friends of the book. So really, this is about them, and I wanted to honor them and have them there as well.
I was so glad you mentioned, though, Charlie Douglas, because he was very important, the road gang, I mean, to truckers everywhere. Right. That 50,000 watts meant a lot to many people. Leon Kellner,
we were talking about the power of WWL, and I always ask, what do people remember? And it's Blue Room, the road gang, some of the jazz shows. They would hear jazz shows across the country because the signal was so strong. And so we have some great photos of you know, jazz bands that would perform and would be picked up all over the country.
Well, and also some of the photos with Louis Armstrong being interviewed by Tony Parenti.
Right.
I mean, that's amazing.
It had some good finds. There were things that I didn't even know existed that we dug up that, you know, over the years.
And you're going to be at the book festival, too,
I'll
aren't
be there
you?
Tomorrow.
As will Tina.
Yeah.
So
we'll be
tomorrow
be
in Baton Rouge, we should point out.
Looking forward to that.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank
and
you.
We turn to Mr. Allen. Busy Bee?
Well, we're going to haunt you with some tricks or treats for theater. You know, first off, I wanted to talk about this one. It's the musical of the Living Dead. This is a follow-up from last year's Evil Dead the musical, and again done by Christopher Bentivenia. It's a wonderful production in terms of low production values, but a lot of blood. And if you like blood for Halloween, this is your ticket. I must tell you, Night of the Living Dead was maybe a little bit more splatter zone-ish, if you will. They have a lot of blood that they have in this one, though. Musical of the Living Dead will more or less haunt you up with a little bit of zombie action. It stars Callie Russell and Avarice Anderson, as well as Edward Simon. And they have a wonderful cast of singers. They really take this to a great extreme with all of the blood. Expect to get splattered no matter what. And you don't know what if it's going to be blood or some other fluid that may hit you, so you never know. All I can tell
Yippee.
You is it's a very charming zombie musical as far as zombie musicals go.
Sign
okay.
me up.
Yeah.
Sign us up.
Bring your galoshes.
Another one that I mentioned right now is Orphans. Now, those of you who are familiar, Orphans was a very famous theatrical piece that was done in Chicago at Steppenwolf, and that goes back to about 1983. If there's anything that I could say that this particular production lacks is maybe a little bit of timeliness, although I thought the cast was fairly good in terms of most of the production staying on point of the characters. There's basically three characters in the play. You've got two brothers, and again, one of the problems with the casting was there was a little wonderment there as to how two brothers are of different race backgrounds. But you do have two brothers. Philip is played by David Williams, and Harold is played by Silas Cooper. And then you've got Treat, Martin Bradford. Now, again, the two brothers are Treat, Martin Bradford, and Philip, David Williams. And they are, of course, taken in by this semi-father figure. Harold is sort of a gangster on the lam. And this is really a story about family and connections. They attempt to take him in, but it turns out that he has really taken them over in terms of what he does. He becomes their father, in a sense, and gives them encouragement and makes them connected in a way. There is a very sad denouement, if you will, but it is predictable, I guess you might say, because of the fact that he is a gangster. But this is an interesting cast. I would give it a high rating, but again, there were some problems with the production in terms of the direction. I thought it lacked a little bit of focus, but overall pretty good. Coming up next week, though, another haunting appearance, none other than the Phantom of the Opera at the Sanger Theater. We're going to have Christine Daae taken by the Phantom, and of course all of the Andrew Lloyd Webber musical that you've come to know and love. This is, after all, the longest running musical in Broadway history, over 11,000 production days that they've had, and of course I believe it's only second to Les Miserables on the West End. Phantom of the Opera is interesting. They're going to have the reviewers come on Friday night. That makes me wonder why we're not coming for opening night. We'll see. Perhaps the production is going to scare us, but we'll see. I want to also mention that Cheyenne Jackson, one of the great stars of Broadway, is coming as part of the Broadway at NOCA series, or the Broadway at Le Petit series. This time it's going to be at NOCA, part of the Mark Cortelli production series. Cheyenne Jackson going to be there November the 7th at 7:30 at the NOCA Riverfront. I want to make sure of the fact that the tickets are still available, and it should be a great show. I'd Rather Be Rich. Now, you probably never heard of that. I think I'd Rather Be Right Than President was maybe a play you heard of, but this is a brand new world premiere play going to be at the Anthony Bean Community Theater starting up this week. And I wanted to mention that it's going to run all the way through November the 23rd. If you get a chance to go check it out, it should be very interesting. I'm looking forward to doing a review on it, but it'll be probably in a couple of weeks. And for those of you who like Broadway and know the wonderful production that George Dansker does with his concerts and lectures that he combines, he's going to have another one coming up at the New Orleans Public Library on, I believe it's the 6th of November, which is unfortunately the same night and daytime as Dominic's book signing. But those of you who don't make it over to that book signing, George is going to have a little look at Broadway from Sondheim to Jerry Herman to Andrew Lloyd Webber, and he's going to have people performing and singing some of the songs. So.
Oh, what a great opportunity.
Yes.
Oh, and it's such a gem, a downtown library. It really is.
I think it's under use, if anything.
Yeah, yeah. Well, very good. We're so fortunate to have The Sanger in all the national plays that come in.
I mean,
we're just, you know, we're getting spoiled.
Well,
but this
yeah.
is, you know.
Yeah, yeah. But I will tell you that also that the Jefferson Performing Arts.
Coming online.
That will be also something to say. We may have a couple of local productions coming in, rolling through maybe some of the regional productions as well.
We're blessed.
Okay.
Thank you. Now it's time, though, for our Artist Spotlight. Tonight, we are featuring Rolling Seas by Vicki Lee. A New Orleans native, Lee studied painting at the New Orleans Academy of Fine Arts. Her work of art was chosen as the first place winner of the Poitras Home Juried Art Show by Art Show Judge Mel Buchanan. The 20th annual Poitras Home Art Show and sale is tomorrow from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And the Poitras Home, of course, is on Magazine at Jefferson Avenue right there. Call 897-0535 or visit poitrashome.com for more information. By the way, many, many talented artists will be there, including jewelry designer Patrice McMurray. Wonderful stuff. She'll be at the art show, too. Visit WYES.org to see our online calendar and to see our lineup of events, but also you can go to WYES.org to see our program online, WYES On Demand. New Orleans Magazine's quiz queen, Julia Street, has a question for us. Last time, Trish Fardella gave us the names of the two oldest existing restaurants in New Orleans, Poppy and Two Jacks. I know she knew that answer. All right. Now, tonight's question. One cemetery is allegedly where Marie Laveau was buried. Another contains a tomb linked to Storyville Madam Josie Arlington. Name them. Email your answers to steppinout@wyes.org. Our prizes, a Louisiana Life magazine subscription, a gift certificate for two, courtesy of Vianne's Tea House, offering their culinary and gourmet tea experience. And tonight, we have a t-shirt as worn by, look, she's back, WYES staffer Kelsey Schreiber, with the message, Beyond a Reasonable Trout, from our friends at wearablevegetables.com. And now our picks, Dominic.
NewOrleansRadioBook.com.
Once again.
Well, besides the book, NewOrleansRadioBook.com has all information on the book. I hope people enjoy it and brings back some great memories.
All right, great. Alan.
I want to mention our calendar will have information about the Rocky Horror Picture Show in line with our Halloween theme, but Southern Rep is going to be presenting the last few performances of Broomstick, the John Biganay play, and again, check it out at the Ashe Cultural Arts Center.
And I'm going to go see Rocky Horror, so I can tell you a little bit about that, too. Tina.
Look us up on Facebook at Artist Spaces New Orleans, the book and beyond.
Very good. Thank you. Puppy.
Don't miss our friend, the Baroness Pontalba's birthday bash, Thursday from 5 until 7, performances by the New Orleans Opera and Louisiana History Alive. That's going to be taking place at the Upper Pontalba on Jackson Square.
Very good. We have so much happening this week. We've got Voodoo Fest. We've got Anne Rice and Christopher Rice of the Garden District Books. But let me tell you about a few other things. Carolyn Kopp, also known as Panny, will be signing her new book, New Orleans Memories. That's tomorrow afternoon at the Louisiana Louisiana Book Festival in Baton Rouge. Visit louisianabookfestival.org to see more details, too. Also, Rick Bragg's up there. And the Sweet Sounds of Music benefiting the Uptown Music Theater Troupe will be held, that's tomorrow evening, at the Xavier University Ballroom. The Dirty Dozen Brass Band are among the many stars performing to help the group raise funds to compete in the National Junior Theatrics Festival coming up in Atlanta. Visit umtno.org for more information on that. And Tina Santee Flaherty presents her new book, What Jackie Taught Us, the Jackie Kennedy, of course, Lessons from the Remarkable Life of Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis. That's at the National World War II Museum next Thursday evening, and a book signing follows, a reception, and it, by the way, there'll be a Q&A moderated by Angela Hill herself. And also, next Thursday, the Pitot House celebrates their 50th anniversary with the Gala History on the Move, visiting, of course, LouisianaLandmarks.org for tickets. And speaking of the Pitot House, we'd like to congratulate James Wade for the recent release of his book, The Pitot House, Landmark on Bayou St. John. Thank you all so much, and welcome to our table.
Well, thank you for having me.
And you've been here before, but we're glad you're here, too.
Always glad to be back.
And thank you, my weekly stalwarts here. Good evening. Good night. Happy Halloween. Very good. I know, we've got to have a cookie. Looking forward to the cookie.
Support for Steppin' Out is made possible by local author Sarada Bonnet. In Notes of Forgiveness, Bonnet shares her childhood story as daughter of famed rockabilly singer Sherry Davis. Notes of Forgiveness, available in bookstores and at saradabonnet.com.